Hello and welcome to Utrecht. This is the Tuindorpkerk and my name is Doreen Schouten. Some of you might remember me from my time in Edinburgh, where I lived for a few years, already 3 years ago now. And I'm very happy to welcome you to the church where I now play every Sunday. And this beautiful organ, the Ruprecht organ. It's a very nice opportunity that we're able to show you this, even though no one is allowed to travel, and that's the joy of technology. I'm not here alone, because I couldn't do this on my own. Also here is Koen, who might be on the video sometimes, and he is trying to get the sound to you as best as possible from here, and also Hetty, who is doing the camera, so thank you very, very much for being here, because I couldn't do it by myself. I'm very happy to be able to show you this instrument. It's a very interesting organ, very special even in the Netherlands. And as you might have guessed, it's a tracker action. So we're used to that here. But the disposition, the registration of this organ is quite special, even in the Netherlands. We are used to having Baroque organs, but mostly they're North German style or Dutch style, like Schnitger, Hinz, etc. This organ was probably built by someone from Westfalen, so German, but also close to the Dutch border. His name was Conrad Ruprecht II. He came from a family of organ builders in the south of the Netherlands, Roermond, and this organ was probably built there. We're not quite sure because all the documentation has been lost, most of it, not all of it, thank God. So we're quite sure it's actually been built by the Conrad Ruprecht II. And I will show you a lot of different registrations today. Just now you heard the plein jeu, as it's called in French. So the we would call it the plenum, I guess, which is not too typical for French Baroque, but it is also used in the German and the Dutch Baroque. So the plenum, all of the prestant stops and the mixtures. And you hear the small plein jeu on the upper manual, which is actually the broestwerk in here, and the grand plein jeu on the great, which is up there, as you can see. So this organ was probably built in Roermond, which is about 150 kilometers from here. It has been moved quite a lot of times, first in Roermond once, and then it came to Utrecht to the Oosterkerk, which is not a church anymore. And in 1985, it came to the Tuindorpkerk, where we are now. So lots of movement, so it has seen a lot of times and lots of different registrations as well. Has been restored quite a lot of times. It's also been looted a few times, so lots of things happened, but luckily it has been restored and renovated in 2000, so not too long ago. And since then, it's been sounding beautiful again. So I wanted to show you the organ based on the second suite of Clérambault, which you heard just to plein jeu just now. I'm now going to play two more pieces from it, the duo and the trio. In the French Baroque, all the suites had specific registrations usually applied to it. And all the organs in France were more or less the same, so with the same stops. So you could just use any organ you wanted and just play with the stops and play the same pieces everywhere in France. But for the duo and trio registrations, there's not much said about that. Duo is just two voices, which you can use two different contrasting stops. And for the trio, there are two different kinds of trios. The one with pedal, so two manuals and one pedal. And the one with one voice in the left hand and two voices in the right hand. And that's the case in this piece. So you will now hear a duo and a trio with different stops. So, you might have heard the reed stop in the left hand in the duo. It's a crom horn, which was very typical for the French Baroque period. This particular one is new, from 2000 actually. So it's not old, but it's been copied actually, from a very old organ. So the sound was probably more or less like it was back then, and that's why it fits in very well with the rest of the organ. Because this organ was built around 1710, probably, which is quite a long while ago. But luckily there are people who can delve into the past and just find out what it was like, and we still have some organs from that time. So that's why people can find out what the sound had been like and try to copy that for this instrument. And I think it works very well. So you can hear the crom horn in the left hand and the sesquialtera in the right hand, and I think that works very nicely together. In the trio you heard more flute stops, so on the right hand the nazar and the flute 4 and 8, and in the left hand also a quint, but not a nazar but a quint flute, and also 8 and 4 flutes. And that's one of the things that are very, very special about this instrument, is that we have so many aliquots. And you might think, okay, what's the difference with a neo-baroque organ where you have only one 8-foot and then lots of aliquots? The difference is that there are even more, I think. So you have two quints on both manuals, there is a sesquialtera on both manuals, and even a cornet on both manuals. So that's very special. And that means you have all these colors. And it's perfect for this kind of music, obviously. And you can just play around with that and try to get as many colors as you want. The reason for that is probably because it was a monastery organ or a cloister organ at first. And back in the day, they didn't do much singing accompanied with organ. So they just wanted it for nice colors, for things like this, or maybe the choir of monks sung one verse of a Gregorian chant, and then there was some organ music, also with different colors. And that's very nice. However, when it came to Utrecht, the Oosterkerk, that was a very different tradition, and I will tell you a little bit more about that later on, before I play a piece, a psalm, Psalm 5 by Corquet. But for now, let me check. I will now play, a little bit more with the reeds and the flutes. So the next two pieces are still from this suite by Clérambeau, and they're called Basse de crom horn and flutes. So the first one is the crom horn in the bass, and then there is an accompaniment in the right hand, and the next one, the flutes, is quite a new registration for that time, because they coupled the great to the swell. It's not called great and swell, but that doesn't matter. So they coupled both manuals with the 8 and 4 flutes, so you get a bit of a tremulant sound. And today we are in luck because the organ sounds very much like a tremolant. And so I think that effect will sound very clearly. So first the Basse de crom horn with the crom horn in the left hand and the accompaniment in the right.
Thank you.
So now you've heard a few different stops from the organ already. Some flutes, some plenum, some reeds, just one, but there will be more. Don't worry. And now I would like to show you how these kind of stops that were used in the French Baroque can also sound in a different way in more modern music. So I've chosen a piece by Dutch composer Daan Manneke. He was born in 1939, so he's still alive. He's quite old by now. And he wrote a piece called De Zonne Reist, which means the sun is rising, which is based on a poem by Guido Gezelle. And I won't quote the poem to you now because it's in Dutch, but it's very nice actually. It's about being in a church on a morning and seeing the sun come up and seeing the sunbeams through the colored windows, painting all kinds of shades of purple and red and yellow on the floor and on the walls. And you can, if you read it, you can imagine all the nice colors that shows. And I think Daan Manneke did a very good job by painting these colors in the music as well. And the last five movements of his De Zonne Reist are actually based on evening hymn, Te Lucis Ante Terminum. It's also in the English hymn book. And I think the Telles Canon was also based on that text. It's the same sort of text. So you pray to God that he will defend you in the night and give you a good night of rest and safety. And Daan Manneke uses in these five movements lots of different colors of the organ in different ways. So you will still hear the kromhorn and the quint flute, but it's used in a very different way, which I think is interesting. Bear with me because I have to do the registrations by myself, so it will take a little bit more time in between movements, but I think it's worth it. Thanks. Thank you. I think that sounds very mystical, very Catholic, you could say. And I promised to talk to you about the Dutch Reformed Church, the Oosterkerk, before. So that's the place where this organ was before 1985. And in the Dutch Reformed tradition, it's very Calvinistic, and there only psalms were sung. So, and you needed quite a big organ to accompany those people. There were like maybe 1,800 people in the church, and on feast days, there could be even 2,000 people in there. So very big, not used for music that much. It was really focused on the word. So it was a very big church, probably not heated. So probably people kept their coats on. And this organ was way too small, actually, to accompany that mass of singing. But the people in the Oosterkerk didn't have much money to buy a different organ. That's why this organ came from Roermond, if you remember. But after a while, they thought, no, we need a different instrument, and the organ came here. And I'm not sure if you are familiar with the tradition of psalm singing in the Netherlands, in the Reformed churches. So the psalms came from Geneva, from Johannes Calvin. He wrote most of the texts. Obviously, they are taken from the Bible, but they are put onto rhyme, so people could sing them in verses. And there were a few people who wrote the melodies and the settings. And they're very popular still in the Netherlands. They're sung almost everywhere every Sunday. So people are very familiar with the Genevan melodies. Also the Dutch organist Cor Kay, by whom I will now play his Psalm 5. If you're not familiar with the melody, you will probably not recognize it in his modern version of this psalm. That's why I decided to play for you first the setting of Goudimel, Claude Goudimel, twice. In case you don't know it, then it might be good to hear it twice before I play the version by Cor Kay. And also here, it's in three movements. So the first one sounds quite modern, quite mechanical, lots of repeated notes. The second movement is the one where you can best hear the melody, so try to catch it if you can. And that's played with a solo stop in the right hand, the sesquialter again, because it's lovely. And the last movement is with a trumpet. I think you haven't heard it before, the trumpet on the manual, on the grate. So that's Psalm 5 by Cor Kay. that was Psalm 5. And the reason I chose this particular psalm, I forgot to say before, is because it's about the morning. And I thought it was a nice contrast with the evening hymn of Daan Manneke. And you can tell it's really a morning piece because it wakes you up straight away, especially that last movement with the trumpet. We are now coming to the end of the program. There are still two more movements left of the Clérambault suite. The Récit de Nazaire and the Caprice sur le Grand Jeu. And I think they're the best movements, actually, so it's good to leave the best for last. The Récit de Nazaire is, maybe you know this, a récit in the French Baroque was a piece for a solo voice. And in this case, it's the solo is for the Nazaire. Which is good because I think the Nazaire on the grate on this organ is lovely. And I think it sounds really, really nice. I coupled it to the swell. I will couple it to the swell in this piece. And you get this nice tremolant sound again. And then the Caprice, the last piece, sur le Grand Jeu. The Grand Jeu, the great works, so to speak, which will feature the trumpets again. The trumpets in the manual and also on the pedal. Yeah, and a caprice is like a joke or maybe a funny movement. So I think Clérambault did that well. And I hope you will enjoy it. And thank you very much for coming all this way to Utrecht to enjoy this nice organ with me. Thanks.